Essentially, this is what must be developed. The art of giving out in love and intelligence what is taken in from vision and the experience of self-transcendence and solidarity with the universe.
To thank all those who have made this great gathering possible and to express our deep admiration for one person in particular who has long been our guide and inspiration. We hope that Dr. Hoffman will hear in our presentations the tribute we intend, as well as our determination to make of his problem child a mature citizen of the world. The world, in fact, may depend on it. I'll now give the podium to Professor Carl Ruck, who will take you on a tour of times and practices long past, which nevertheless have a great significance for our own times.
We have taken this road many times, and this time I think we have found the actual pathway, the footsteps. And so if you will come along with us, I think I can show you, we can show you what the initiation offered. We're going to retrace the sacred road and mix the kukian once again. There is nothing sacred about the sacred road today except its name. It leaves what was once the ancient city of Athens amidst ramshackle shops and industrial buildings, passing through dismal suburbs as it slowly rises toward the low ridge on the barren mountain that encloses the western limit of the Attic plain. On the crest, the ancient pilgrim would pause to rest in a grove of laurel trees sacred to Apollo. It is they that still give their name to the place, but long ago, a Christian monastery was built there out of the ancient stones to obliterate the memory of the pagan traveler. And the surrounding pine forest is now the site for the annual Daphne Wine Festival. From the ridge, the road descended into the once fertile Rarian plain. It was here, they said, that grain had first been planted. Today, the plain is the most highly industrialized area in Greece, and although the road follows its original path along the shore, the narrow bay of Salamis, where the Athenians once defeated the vastly superior Persian fleet, is now congested with tankers riding at anchor, unloading petroleum to the clusters of storage facilities and refineries. The trip to Eleusis used to be mimetic of a journey to the other world, to claim back from death the daughter of the grain mother, Demeter, whose sorrow for her lost daughter could be assuaged only through the mystery of rebirth. A traveler on the modern highway is apt not even to notice the remains of the sanctuary of the love goddess Aphrodite on the right at the base of the descent, or the brackish streams that were thought to flow from a subterranean source and that formed the shallow lake that was the boundary between the two realms. A narrow causeway bridged the lake, and on the other side, hereditary priests met the procession of initiates and tied a saffron wristband on each and another on their ankles as an indication that they had crossed the frontier. Just beyond, on the road that lay ahead, there was one further ordeal, a narrow bridge lined with villagers from the sanctuary who shouted obscenities and verbal abuse as the candidates filed through. At Eleusis itself, the religion towards which the ancient traveler made his way was shielded from profane observances by the sanctuary's fortification wall, and the essential dogma was imparted only to those who, under pain of death, had vowed to keep it secret and had undergone a lengthy preparation for their initiation. The ancient Greco-Roman world worshipped in established religions supported by the governments, like the officially recognized religious denominations of today. But the official cults, in their great diversity, failed to offer a sense of individual identity and special communion with the deities of the other world. In various private or more emotive and ecstatic cults and rituals, the individual was afforded an experience of personal communion with deity, involving secrets of actions and meanings that were hidden and whose divulging outside the community of initiates was prohibited under the penalty of death. These cults were called mysteries. The major of the mysteries was the one practiced for two millennia at the village of Eleusis, to the west of Athens, called the Eleusinian Mystery. At Eleusis, the deities were a duo of females, Demeter and Persephone, interchangeable in their roles as mother and daughter, hence known simply as the religion of the two goddesses, with a third female lurking in the background, the postmenopausal crone Hecate, patroness of drugs and witchcraft, who united them as a triad, triumphant over the dominant males, who feared their power and attempted to separate their intuitive and physiological communion by sequestering them as wives isolated within a husband's household. The initiation into their cult restored them to primacy, at least in the religious realm, and taught both males and females how to live in tune with the incomprehensible phenomenon of the continuity of life and death, and the awesome powers of the once dominant goddess and the forces of nature. The desecrated sanctuary has lost its numinous aura today, all its gods long since dead or chased away. But in Athens, some 20 feet lower than the modern city, we can still stand on a portion of the sacred road, where it first left the city gate, passing through the monuments of the ancient cemetery. From this excavation, the intervening city disappears, and we can look up across the centuries directly to the Acropolis. In the swampy ground that lies along the road, reeds grow and flower profusely. And amidst the croaking of frogs, we can almost expect still to hear the exultant cries of the initiates as they set out for Eleusis, calling upon Iacchus, as in the Eleusinian chorus of Aristophanes' Frogs. It was this Iacchus who would lead them to the mystery. Iacchus is the personification of their ecstatic cry. His real identity was part of the secret, probably an epithet of Dionysus. "Come now to the sacred circle of the goddess," they sing, "to the flowering grove. We who have been given liberty to play at the god-beloved festival, I shall go with my holy torch, playing with the maidens and the ladies, where all night long they celebrate the goddess. Let us go then to the well-watered flowering meadows. For us alone is there sun there and cheerful light, we who have been initiated and conduct ourselves with pieties." Aristophanes, Frogs, the Chorus of Initiates. Greek comedy was oxymoronically a sacred obscenity. The chorus is a group of men costumed with the holy phallus, here identified metaphorically as the torches borne high in the procession, with which they want to play with the women. Quote, "Come now, how shall I knock on the doorway? What's the way the people here do it?" Knock on that doorway? Need we suggest what the circle of the goddess might be? Indeed, they are about to pass through the gateway to the flowering meadows, to the other world beyond. Come with us as we retrace the way of the goddess with the ancient initiates to rediscover the world that lay beyond her doorway, and the way that the indigenous people down there knew the secret of entering her. It is a theme well documented in the religion of the goddess. The doorway is the spread vulva of the Celtic Sheila Magig and her many analogs in the ancient world. including the one just as explicit, an obscene dwarf that we shall encounter at Eleusis, where she bore the name of Babo. Sheila Nagig was depicted as a grinning, aged woman with a bony rib cage, a crone. As is the custom with displaced religions, she was assimilated into the personae that replaced her, the old stone carvings often built into the new church, placed above the doorway with the almond-shaped entrance, or mandorla, beneath her legs, enlarging the same opening into the sacred enclosure. In a chorus of Euripides' Ion, we also catch something of the ancient exaltation. There they speak of the holy sixth night, when the initiates at last would arrive at the sacred well beside the sanctuary gate at Eleusis, probably after nightfall, since the last stretch of the procession along the shore was lit with torches. Here they would sing and dance without sleep until exhaustion, in honor of Dionysus and of the sacred mother and daughter, who were Demeter and Persephone. And with them in their dance would dance also the starry sky and the moon and all 50 daughters of ocean rising out of rivers and from the sea. The hallucinatory nature of their dancing universe was the prelude to what would be seen once the initiates passed within the sanctuary's walls and entered the house of the goddess. For there, huddled in the darkness within the initiation hall, they saw something that validated the continuity of existence beyond the grave, the end of life, as well as its divinely granted beginning. And indeed, this is what has been such a dilemma about Eleusis, for something must have been seen there. All our ancient testimony insists upon that fact. Authors like the poet of the Homeric hymn to Demeter, and the tragedian Sophocles and Euripides, to have seen the holy, ta hiera. It was in that way that one could speak safely of the mystery. Up to that moment, the initiate was a mystes, with his eyes closed to the world. He came to that state through the preparatory initiation of the lesser mystery, a year and a half earlier in February, in the sanctuary on the banks of the Eleusis River at Agrae. The words for mystery, mysterion, and initiate, mystes, have the mu syllable as their root. The voiced nasal labial consonant, made with the lips pursed, emitting no sound, for a secret well kept, like English, mums the word. The same syllable occurs in squinted-eyed, or myopic, muops. Mystes was the first stage, mouth and eyes shut. But at Eleusis, one had the vision, the epopteia, and became someone who had seen, an epoptes. In Greek, knowledge and seeing are inseparable, the former resulting from experiencing the latter. Even a theory, in Greek, implies a sacred journey to witness something holy. Yet archaeologists have not found the holy Tahira at Eleusis, although they did actually expect that they would. And in the absence of any excavated object, scholars have been free to fantasize whatever they wanted these mysterious Hiera to have been. These holy things were supposedly stored in a small building or freestanding chamber within the initiation hall. At the moment of the revelation, the Hierophant opened a door on that ancient house of the goddess, and in the midst of a great light, he showed Tahira, let them loose. The ancient testimony about Eleusis is unanimous. Eleusis was the supreme experience in an initiate's life. It was both physical and mystical, trembling, vertigo, cold, sweat, and then a sight that made all previous seeing seem like blindness, a sense of awe and wonder, at a brilliance that caused a profound silence, since what had just been seen and felt could never be communicated. Words are unequal to the task. Those symptoms are unmistakably the experience induced by an entheogen, to use the now widely accepted neologism, to avoid the pejorative implications of words like drug or hallucinogen. Simply put, the hiera, or holy, cannot be found in this world. The testimony is clear that what was seen wasn't something of this world, but something there in the other world. One had to journey beyond the earth, beneath the earth, to witness the holy. The Hierophant was the one who made the holy appear. But when he opened the door on the chamber, it broke the seal between the worlds and opened a rift in the cosmic fabric. But few initiates, however, could actually have seen him physically or materially in the telesterion or initiation hall. Named in Greek as the teleological culmination, the telos or end, rather than the Latin initium or initial beginning. It didn't matter because the vision didn't materialize there at the door opened on the goddess's house. The telesterion was not a theater and was in other ways completely unsuitable for witnessing the Hierophant's activity. The building was actually cut out of the Acropolis rock at Eleusis, essentially an architectural simulacrum of a subterranean chamber or cave. It was rebuilt and enlarged at various times to accommodate the increasing numbers of initiates, but in all its modifications, an essential design was maintained. The telesterion was a rectilinear building built around a much smaller rectangular chamber, the anacteron, or dwelling of the mistress. In the later telesterion, at least, the roof above the anacteron was constructed as a lantern, emitting the only light from outside and affording ventilation for torches and oil lamps. The topographical position of the anacteron was kept virtually constant throughout the reconstructions, built always on the site of the most ancient Mycenaean original, what the archaeologists label the Mycenaean megaron, or great chamber. Its relative placement within the telesterion, however, varied from period to period. The actual telesterion was merely an enshrining of this most ancient holy of holies. This was the original house of the goddess, towards which Aristophanes' initiates were journeying, intending to knock on her door with their erections. Actually, Greek scholars should have had no difficulty in recognizing that the hiera need not have referred to specific objects, but to the whole realm of the holy, holiness, the experience and ceremony of religion. Physical objects were not what the Hierophant released from the antique dwelling as the stars and moon began to dance. Heracles was said to have been more precise about what was seen. It was Persephone herself. In a papyrus fragment, he claims that he had no need of the initiation because he had already seen her when he descended into Hades. According to Euripides, it was this vision that allowed him to triumph over death. He was able to join with the other mystae for his resurfacing to the land of the living as one who had seen an epoptes. Here too, we must remember the initiation hall was not a theater. The view would have been obstructed from most angles. No money is recorded in the account books for expenditures on theatrical equipment or actors at Eleusis, nor is it likely that the Greeks, who were so sophisticated about drama, would have fallen for a dumb show, some trick of stagecraft. It was not an actor, but Persephone herself who was seen, a schemati, a form or appearance of some kind, hovering above the ground, as one source claimed. Plato more explicitly called them phasmata, or ghostly apparitions. The initiation hall became filled with spirits. It was something that even a blind man could see. A certain Eucrates of the 5th century BCE dedicated a painted marble votive plaque. Without eyes, he saw the goddess. Over the inscription are his sightless eyes, above which rises the carved face and goddess, the head of the goddess, surrounded by red rays. Clearly, a hallucinatory reality was induced within the initiation hall. And since at times as many as several thousand initiates with their attendants, a number greater than the population of an ordinary ancient town, were afforded such a vision annually on schedule, it would seem obvious that some psychoactive substance, an entheogenic Eucharist, was involved. And indeed, we do know that the drinking of a special potion, the kukion, was an essential part of the mystery. This Eleusinian mixed kukion was first prepared for Demeter by the bizarre servant of the queen in the old house of the goddess, preserved as the enshrined Anacteron within the Telesterion. Exhausted from searching for her abducted daughter Persephone, Demeter arrived at the Well of Beautiful Dancing, as it was called, just outside the gate to what would become the Eleusinian sanctuary. It was here that the initiates in later times would dance until exhaustion after their long walk from Athens on the sacred way, before passing through the portals into the forbidden inner sanctuary. Maidens who had come to draw water from the well invited Demeter into the house, and she hit her head on the roof as she entered, for the inhabitants were the wee people of the other world. She refused to sit in the glittering chair relinquished by her hostess. Instead, the devious servant woman, Iambe, offered her a stool covered with a ram's fleece, where she sat mirthless until the same scheming creature amused her with jokes and made the holy lady laugh, doing something that would become an element in the later mysteries. This jest of Iambe was explicitly obscene and is recorded in considerable detail. She hitched up her dress and displayed her private parts. It was this spectacle that so pleased the goddess that she accepted the drink that would open the door to the world beyond. It is a theme well documented from other ancient cultures. The Egyptian cow goddess Hathor did the same thing to cheer her father Ra. What is cheering about the jest is simply the view through the vulva to the world beyond. The dwarfish servant's name is the personification of the iambic metrical rhythm, which was originally employed for obscene verses and dances. She is sometimes depicted with the musical instrument that she would have used to accompany her song and dance. But it wasn't only her mystical doorway that she displayed. She revealed it in action. She had another name as well. She could be called Baobo, which is the word for dildo. And when she exposed herself, there was someone lurking within the doorway. This was Iacchus, the personification of the cries of the joyous procession. And he emerged and took up a position beneath her breasts as her nursling son birthed through the portal from the other world. As the initiates filed into the Telesterion, they had passed the cave of Pluto as they proceeded up the incline along the final stretch of the long sacred road toward the great hall of the mystery. It was there in the narrow channel at the cave's depths, plunging down to subterranean caverns, that Persephone had descended into the netherworld. In the mystery, they would journey in the soul along that same shamanic pathway. And at the moment of the vision, the Hierophant would open the door on the goddess's little house, and the triumphant procession, led by the joyous shouts of Iacchus, would file out through into a brilliance of mystical illumination, born again through the vulva of the scheming Iambe back into this world. Thus, at the climax of the Eleusinian vision, the Hierophant, in a falsetto voice, proclaimed, a voice that disguised his sex, solemnly intoned the great refrain, "The Lady Brimo has given birth to the Lord Brimos." It was accompanied by the striking of the gong that was used in the theater imitate the thundering sound of an earthquake as the ground gapes open, affording a passageway from the netherworld. The initiates had arrived at the house of Hades down in the Elysian fields at a moment of cosmic significance. The queen was about to be delivered of a child, and the initiates, resurfacing with her through the sacred door on the ancient tabernacle with a rapid alteration of emotions, were born again along with them. Both Elysium and Eleusis are named as the places of arrival, the two separated merely on the vertical axis. They saw Persephone in the midst of a great light with her son. Brimo and Brimus were ancient names and needed to be glossed by the source that recorded them. They are the mighty or terrible ones. The sacred myth that narrates the events involved in the founding of the mystery is recorded in the so-called Homeric Hymn to Demeter, an anonymous poem dating from the 7th century BCE, 7 centuries later than the probable date of the first performance of the mystery. In it, we are told how the goddess Persephone was abducted by her bridegroom Hades to the realm of the dead when she picked a special 100-headed Narcissus while gathering the flowers with a sisterhood of maidens called the Daughters of Ocean in a place called Nyssa. The name of the flower comes from the pre-Greek language, but it is the origin of narcotic in the modern languages. It is well documented in Minoan art, where we see it in sacred decorations and visionary shamanic contexts, identifiable as the psychoactive seed asphodel. The abduction was the theme of the Lesser Mystery, enacted in February, a year and a half earlier. And at some point, the symbolism of the narcotic wildflower assimilated traditions of a psychoactive mushroom, the wildest of uncultivatable plants, as the agent for the narcosis. It is probable that the sacramental Eucharist of the Lesser Mystery was not a general communion, but restricted to the titular queen of Athens, who slept with the god Dionysus each year on that date. The god who was equated with Hades and was named the god of Nyssa, the second element of his name. The mystical Nyssa is a place where one closed one's eyes as a mystes in preparation for the awakening. For the verb nistadzo persists in modern Greek, meaning become sleepy. There was a conspiracy afoot involved in this abduction of Persephone. Its object was to incorporate death into the grand design. The unlikely trio was Zeus and his brother Hades, with the complicity of Earth. The narcotic flower and the ensuing abduction by Hades were in fulfillment of the plan or grand design of Zeus. As the daughter of Zeus by his sister Demeter, Persephone had impeccable Olympian lineage and was destined, like them, to be immortal, since both of her parents were immortal. In the original division of the realms, however, Zeus had claimed the heavens, his brother Poseidon the waters, and it fell to their brother Hades to rule the netherworld. By the abduction, Persephone entered the netherworld, where she might have maintained her Olympian status if she had not taken matter into her body, since her spiritual nourishment as an immortal could consist only of nectar and ambrosia. She was tricked, however, to eat a seed of pomegranate. By the seed, she sullied her celestial purity and became pregnant. And as the wedded wife of Hades, she passed into the control of his house. Thereafter, she was an in-law of the Olympians, and she and her mother were frequent visitors. The marital alliance stabilized the cosmos, incorporating the netherworld into the grand design. From the seed, she gave birth to the mystery child. The child had many names, or more appropriately, epithets. He was ultimately the pacification of death. In the Plutonian cave at Eleusis, he was portrayed as the personification of the plan or grand design, given the name of Eubuleus. Instead of some kind of deathly monstrosity, he is a handsome, totally Hellenized adolescent. So what was the botanical agent that could orchestrate the final journey through the opened door at the greater mystery, celebrated in the last week of September? The formula for the Kukian is unambiguous. Fleabane and barley and water. Suspicion for a psychoactive agent first fell upon the fleabane, since obviously the barley was innocuous. Menthopelagium, in botanic nomenclature, a sweet-smelling mint with the second element in adjectival form of flea, pulex, corrupted in English as penny royale, which is to say flea royale. It has definite toxic properties, hence its common name from its use as an insecticide or a repellent. The ingestion of a large dosage produces massive necrosis of the central lobular region of the brain, swelling of the lungs, internal bleeding, seizure, coma, and even death. It would hardly qualify as a psychoactive Eucharist. Nor is it possible to conceive of the large quantities required, the maceration, etc., in the mystery chamber. Its mythical traditions, however, identify it with illicit sexuality, a contraceptive and abortifacient. It represents the toxic wild plants of the abduction of the lesser mystery, whereas the greater mystery centers upon the resurrection and the establishment of the rites of cultivation represented by the barley, the foodstuff of life. This was the mystery that Demeter taught to the Eleusinian prince Triptolemus, who has various identities, but ultimately his name too is merely an epithet as the triple warrior. He too is the mystery child leading the procession through the opened door. As Paul rephrased the mystery, the seed thou sowest cometh not to life except it die, 1 Corinthians. In ancient ethnobotany, the edible plants were seen as beneficial hybrids of more toxic ancient ancestors. This is to some extent true, as for example, the edible American or Indian corn, which the Maya Aztecs evolved by selectively planting at each sowing only the more sturdy exemplars of the grain-bearing grasses from the previous harvest. It required continual vigilance, since left to its own recidivist inclination, the grass would tend to revert to its more primitive form. This can be sensed in the case of American corn, with its enormously developed edible cob, still larger today than its Mesoamerican precedents. If left alone, the kernels would all fall in the same spot, and when they germinated, they would compete and crowd each other out, making each sprouting smaller than the previous, as the grain reverted to sheaves of its more ancient, less nourishing, grassy ancestor. This ancestor of barley was an invasive, grassy weed that has the botanical designation of Lolium temulentum, or drunken lolium. It is commonly known as the biblical tares, a weed that is a plague in the fields of grain, a word derived from a Middle High German word for fool. And it is also known as darnel, a word derived from dizzy. Its supposed intoxicating properties are further sensed in its French name is ivre, that is to say ivre, drunk, which appears also in English as ivry. In German, it is called tomalok, giddy legs. In ancient Roman traditions, the plant affects the eyesight, which is to say that they were aware of its visionary properties. The plant, however, is totally lacking in psychoactive principles. So therein is an enigma. The psychoactive properties of darnel derived entirely from a fungal parasite to which it is particularly prone. This appears as the sclerotia, or hardened mass, of the mycelium, the root-like growth of the mushroom, which permeates the individual kernels of the grass, enlarging them and imparting a characteristic red color. It is commonly called rust and ergot, the latter word from the French for the spur or pointed talon on a cock's leg, which it resembles, hence its name also as cockle in English. The botanical nomenclature, it is called Claviceps purpurea, or purple keyhead, clavis, since the ancient key was shaped like a knobbed bolt. Ergot is highly toxic, producing ergotism, variously known as St. Anthony's Fire and St. Vitus's Dance, after the monastic communities that administered to the afflicted, although the cause was not known until the 17th century. In 1938, while investigating the potential therapeutic use of derivatives of the toxic alkaloids of ergot, Dr. Albert Hofmann synthesized a chemical he named LSD, 25th in the series, whose visionary properties he did not discover until his historic bicycle ride of 1943, therefore stumbling upon this 4,000-year-old secret. The abduction of the lesser mystery involved wild plants, symbolized by the fleabane and the mushroom, the latter being the wildest of growths and lacking any apparent seed and defying cultivation. Both plants, moreover, fleabane and Amanita muscaria mushroom, were linked in being the bane of insects, which are interchangeable symbolically as to species and generically and generally were depicted as tiny flying souls of the departed. The common name of the muscaria is fly agaric, from the belief that it kills flies, whereas the insects are actually attracted to its psychoactive juice, which induces only a death-like swoon from which they later recover. Bread, as the sacramental food produced from barley, is inextricably involved in metaphors of fungal growth. It was symbolic of the cosmos, hence made spherical, and incised with the Greek chi, indicative of the crossings of the bands of the celestial and equinoctial and solar zodiacal elliptic, easily assimilated in the Greek Orthodox Church as the crucifix of the Savior. In ancient Greek, bread was called artos, meaning something fitted together. The Pythagoreans had a taboo against breaking bread, which was meant to bring friends together. For, as they said, some believe that the whole universe had its origin from it. In Iranian Zoroastrianism, the universe came into being like a moist, doughy mass, rapidly fermenting and generating internal heat and gas, and expanding upward like the sudden growth of the mushroom, spongy, which yielded the Latin word fungus, fungus. There could be no metaphor more apt to describe the incarnation of spirit and matter. The Indo-Iranian word for swell up combines the basic ideas of hollowing out of space, seething, and forming an outer crust or skin. The same root in English yields heap and heave, hence heaven is what was heaved upwards to the outer perimeter of the cosmos. Etymologically, as what is fitted together, artos is identical with the Persian arch and Sanskrit amsh, which can be vocalized as ambrosia, the food of the gods. The greater mystery, like the controlled fungal process that yielded the bread of Demeter and the wine of Dionysus, the true great triumphs of cultivation, similarly conquered putrefaction by enlisting the mushroom. The ergot-infested kernels of barley were not thought to be different, a different plant from the host, just enlarged kernels, perhaps simply baked by the sun. The potion combined the wild fleabane and the barley that was prototypic of cultivation. The balance, furthermore, is perfect in that the fleabane was an abortifacient and the ergot a birthing drug, in the pharmacopoeia of the midwife. The mushroom is the perfect symbolic mediator between the two, and in fact, the infested kernels would have a special significance, since when they fall to the ground in the appropriate conditions, the mycelia, like any mushroom, send up the fruiting bodies of the characteristic mushroom shape and large enough to be viewed with the unaided eye. The ergots would appear to be the missing seed of the mushroom, now identifiable as the seed of grain. It would have been noticed also that the ergot kernels exude a viscous honeydew, which is similarly attractive to flies. It was long thought to be just the sap of the grain exuded when the insects bore into the kernels. Ergot was the psychoactive ingredient, fitting perfectly the required symbolism and affording the chemical agent sufficient to induce a journey as rigorous as the descent into the netherworld and the return through the opened doorway of the goddess. It also would have to have been novel enough to warrant its illegal profane use and the risk of the extreme penalties that disclosure incurred. Presumably, such recreational use would have been pleasurable beyond an ordinary alcoholic intoxication of wine fortified with herbs, but devoid of sacred meaning. These herbal additives included the full pharmacopoeia, including opium, thorn apple, henbane, and mandrake, as well as cannabis. So we're looking for something better than that. I leave it now to my colleague Peter Webster to uncover the chemistry of the ergotoxins as we mix the kukian anew. Where's the remote?
You can sit next to Alan, and Alan has he needs the text.
He's doing it.
Yeah.
Okay.
There, that's better. There's the first image. Long enduring mysteries may sometimes acquire a certain charm or even charisma, something we would normally only associate with a personality. Indeed, when a notorious mystery is finally solved, we may feel emotionally distraught, as if an old friend had suddenly left us forever. In our hearts, we love our mysteries, and often we really do not want them solved, especially if that solution turns out to be something that might well have been discovered long ago. The messenger who brings news of a mystery's demise may therefore not be believed. He may even be dismissed as a fool for having dared to tread where so many heroes had explored but come back empty-handed. How dare this presumptuous upstart try to take our beloved mystery from us? The reception that The Road to Eleusis first encountered was not far from that. The book and its authors were misinterpreted, misquoted, misreviewed, and mistook as mere pretenders to expertise on the age-old question that so many famous names had tried and failed to answer, and not to mention ignored. As Carl Ruck wrote to me when I was composing a review of the 20th anniversary edition of The Road to Eleusis, The book excited no interest amongst colleagues in my profession, and rarely has anyone even mentioned it to me. The discussion of Dionysos and Greek wine, including the symbolic significance of the Thyrsos, has been completely ignored by classicists, and the work on Eleusis rarely earns even a disparaging footnote in treatments of Greek religion. More recently, the Eleusinian mystery has been expropriated for the curriculum in women's studies, but despite the grain goddess, ethnobotany is not on their agenda, and they too don't speak to me. Students who work with me have even been warned that they will be blacklisted. My textbooks at grammar as well, as if by contagion, are viewed by some as suspect and a threat to normalcy. It wasn't until many years later that a very positive appraisal of the Road to Eleusis was finally published in a major journal. The author of this article, Sean Iyer, concluded that the Wasson-Hoffman-Ruck theory is perhaps the first truly realistic explanation for the most documented aspect of the sacred mysteries. Their profound, beneficial, and lasting effects upon the millions of initiates who, at one time or another, stood enraptured on the steps of the torch-lit telesterion. A careful reading of this essay, however, revealed that the mystery of Eleusis was still not totally solved, at least not in its chemical and pharmacological dimensions. Waiting for the telecommit. Back. One more. Back. That's it. No. One more forward. That's it. Sorry about that. And perhaps in response to the article of Sean Iyer, Ivan Valenchik, the following year, published a criticism of the Eleusis theory that centered on that very topic, the chemical and pharmacological nature of the Kukion, the secret sacramental drink of the greater mysteries of Eleusis. After a detailed and convincing critique, Valenchik concluded that he agreed with Robert Graves and Terence McKenna that psilocybe mushrooms and not ergot might have been the psychoactive secret of the Kaikion, the Kukion. Having been a devotee of the Wasson-Hoffman-Ruck theory since I first read The Road to Eleusis in 1980, Valenchik's criticism seemed to need some rebuttal. And to that effect, I wrote a paper for my website, The Psychedelic Library. You will immediately notice, of course, that I chose to decorate the homepage of the library with an illustration of ergot, whose scientific name is Claviceps purpurea. This, of course, is the parasitic fungus that the Wasson-Hoffman-Ruck theory proposes as the secret ingredient of the Kaikion. The paper that I wrote, The Secret of the Kaikion, attempted to show that, despite some problems, the ergot fungus should still be considered as the first choice for the Kukion's psychoactive ingredient. At the time, however, I had no further ideas on how the ergot hypothesis might be improved. It wasn't for a few more years, while discussing the topic by email with Dan Perrine and Professor Dave Nichols, that I quite suddenly remembered some old references I had read about how lysergic acid was first isolated from reaction mixtures. In an effort to elucidate the molecular structure of these compounds, researchers had been studying how the natural alkaloids of ergot were cleaved into various fragments. One of these reactions was the basic hydrolysis of the alkaloids of ergot. This work had been carried out in the 1930s, and certain aspects of it had apparently been all but forgotten by some researchers ever since. What the work showed was that the predominant alkaloids of ergot, the toxic and ergotism-producing ergopeptines, such as ergotamine, could be partially hydrolyzed to ergine rather than completely hydrolyzed to lysergic acid, depending on the conditions of the reaction. I realized that these findings might have finally provided the missing link for how the preparation of the Kukion could have been accomplished. It seemed that with quite a simple procedure, the entire alkaloid content of ergot could be converted to a simple and psychoactive lysergic acid derivative called ergine. To illustrate these processes and reactions, I will show you some diagrams and models of these compounds in a few moments. Next. With Dan Perrine and Carl Ruck, I soon published a paper in Eleusis detailing my findings and proposing a recipe for how the kakion might have been prepared by the Eleusis priests. Giorgio Samarini, the editor and publisher of the journal, was so generous as to write me that, indeed, it is really a good article, and I'm thinking now you may really have found the key concerning the Eleusinian mysteries. My full compliments for this. Here we see the reaction mechanism proposed by Professor Dave Nichols for our paper. The first stage of the reaction, the partial hydrolysis of ergotamine and its chemical cousins to ergine, can be brought about by fairly mild basic conditions, such as a slurry of wood ash, ashes of wood in water might provide. Only in much stronger basic conditions does the hydrolysis proceed to the next stage to produce lysergic acid itself. The Kukian recipe we propose in the Eleusis paper suggests precisely this. Finely ground ergot would be digested for a time in a mixture of wood ash and water, probably at elevated temperature. Wood ash, of course, contains potassium carbonate, and stirred in water can easily produce a solution of at least pH 9 or 10. Now, what makes this proposal doubly interesting is that ergine is the very same lysergic acid amide that had become famous as one of the shamanic drugs of ancient Central America. Ergine, the simplest lysergic acid amide, was the principal alkaloid of the seed of either of two morning glory vines called Ololiuqui by the Aztecs of ancient Mexico. According to our proposals, therefore, the shamans of Mesoamerica and the priests of ancient Greece had discovered the very same psychedelic agent, albeit in two extremely different plants, one a flowering vine, the other a primitive parasitic fungus. Our claim that ergine was the ingredient of interest in both Ololiuqui and the Kukian would be a hypothesis that had some considerable advantages over the original suggestions in Albert Hoffman's essay in The Road to Eleusis. Dr. Hoffman had proposed that it might have been another simple lysergic acid amide, ergonovine, that the Eleusis priests had learned how to obtain from ergot using a simple water extraction. According to this proposal, they might have thus eliminated the toxic ergopeptines of such as ergotamine. And the presence of these toxic ergopeptines was one of the most important objections to the idea that ergot could have been the Kukian's secret ingredient. And these three diagrams you have just seen, you can easily observe how all these chemicals are derivatives of the basic structure at the left. The lysergic acid, or ergoline base, of all the ergot alkaloids. Here are the three chemicals once more, advance three. Okay. There were two remaining problems with Hoffman's ergonovine proposal, however. Firstly, self-tests by a few interested researchers revealed that ergonovine did not seem suitably or sufficiently psychoactive to fulfill the kakion's reputation. Secondly, ergonovine is a minor and quite variable component of ergot, making it doubtful that a psychoactive kakion could have been prepared reliably for nearly 2,000 years. One more. Once more. Once more. There we go. One more. There we go. No. I'd like to take you all now on a short guided tour of the lysergic acid molecule and its derivatives, particularly to show you some rather unusual characteristics of ergine, the simplest of the lysergic amides, and the substance we now claim was the essential psychoactive component of the kukion. I have prepared a series of diagrams that will, I hope, make it possible for those who have only a vague understanding of organic chemistry to nevertheless get at least the drift of my arguments. Here on the top left, we see the base molecule of all the ergot alkaloids, lysergic acid. Note how the structure is numbered and how the rings are labeled, A, B, C, and D. We will be most concerned with the D ring of the molecule and the way in which the hydrogen and the amide group are attached at position 8. The table shows the amides that result from the reaction of lysergic acid with various amines. To synthesize ergine, we see that it is necessary only to react lysergic acid with ammonia, ergine. Ergine is also known as lysergic acid amide. It is the simplest lysergic acid amide. But to be more correct and specific, and as you will see in a moment, it is not just ergine, but also its mirror image molecule, or epimer, isoergine, that enters the picture. For there seems to be a problem with the proposal that ergine might be the psychoactive compound of the kukion, or even of ololuqui. The problem is similar to that of ergonovine mentioned above. When some researchers have tested the alkaloid as a pure compound, it did not seem to have the psychoactive qualities that make for an effective entheogen. These tests were summarized in the second part of our paper in the Eleusis Journal. There have similarly been doubts that the ololuqui of the Aztecs was a potent psychoactive for self-tests using the seeds of the Pomoya morning glory vine have also been inconclusive in some cases. There have even been suggestions that the effect of ololuqui was entirely due to suggestion. It does seem absurd, however, to suppose that the Central American shamans would have employed a mere placebo when they had such a wide range of undeniably powerful psychoactives at hand, including peyote and psilocybe. And as Jonathan Ott has pointed out in a letter he wrote to us, ololuqui was far more prominent as an entheogen here in Mesoamerica than those mushrooms. The mushrooms are mentioned only here and there by a few competent chroniclers, yet almost an entire book was devoted to denouncing mainly the ololuqui heresy or idolatry. The annals of the Inquisition contain many more autos de fe for ololuqui than for mushrooms. So let's take a closer look at ergine and its mirror image epimer, isoergine. We're one ahead, but just keep it there. Here's a model that should be easier to understand than the shorthand diagrams of the previous slides, especially if you've forgotten your organic chemistry lessons. Here we see the carbon atoms are in gray, and you can see how they form the backbone of the lysergic acid ring structure. Also joining in are nitrogen atoms in blue, hydrogen atoms in white, but we're one image ahead, so they've been eliminated already, not a problem, and a lonely oxygen in red. Now, we've already ignored the hydrogens, and in this model, let's see, ergino hydrogens, we're already one ahead of that. Now, in this model, it might first seem that the whole molecule is almost flat, but let's take a closer look at the bonds in the topmost, or D ring. And that topmost ring is now here. The attachment points of the bonds going to the blue nitrogen and the position 8 carbon imply that these atoms are behind the plane of the molecule. And we've already rotated it clockwise. Now let's try the next image and see if this one works. We're going to rotate the molecule again along its horizontal axis so that the top of the molecule recedes from our vision. Try the next one. This is a big one. I hope it's going to come out. Okay, there we go. So we're rotating it along a horizontal axis. Now we can clearly see that the D ring of ergine has a distinctly zigzag shape, whereas the rest of the molecule is basically flat, with all the carbons almost in one plane. Now, let's go to some models that I've drawn myself with somewhat exaggerated features that will better illustrate what is happening with the D ring of ergine. There we go. Here the molecule is in the same position as in the last slide, but I've changed the colors and put back the hydrogens as small blue spheres adhering directly to their respective carbons. Ergine exhibits what might at first seem a bizarre behavior. Not only does the D ring have a decidedly zigzag shape, it is constantly flipping back and forth to an alternate shape, or as chemists call it, a conformation, as we see here. There it is. This is the second conformation. There are two of them. In this one, you can see the shape, the zigzag shape, is entirely opposite from the model before. And ergine constantly flips itself back and forth between these two conformations. Let's try the animation now, the next one, and see if this one works. We'll have an animation of this D ring flipping back and forth, I hope, in a minute. Here we go. So this is the process that is constantly happening to this molecule. As it absorbs energy, releases energy, this conformation change continually takes place. Next one. Here's the two conformations side by side. And we designate them as the chair conformation and the boat conformation, which is basically the kind of shape that this D ring takes. The term conformation indicates that the forms differ only in their shape, not in the absolute positions of the atoms of the molecule, just the shape that they take. Now we must consider another change that ergine and all lysergic acid alkaloids undergo, and this also is a change in shape. But to arrive at the change, two constituents of the molecule actually trade places. The process is called epimerization, which I've just mentioned before, and proceeds through the formation of an intermediate compound, you see, which is different than the final, than the beginning and the final compound. This is quite a bit different. There's a double bond there. The overall change brought about is merely the changing places of the hydrogen and the amide side chain attached at the carbon atom in position 8. When this happens, we have the isoform of the alkaloid, and for ergine, this is called isoergine. The reaction is reversible, as we see by the double reaction arrows. And so, after a certain time, we can expect that the reaction will arrive at an equilibrium, and both ergine and isoergine will exist in the particular medium under consideration. The epimerization is thus typified in the case of each specific lysergic acid amide by an equilibrium concentration and a time to arrive at that equilibrium. These factors are determined by the chemical and physical environment in which the molecule finds itself. Here are the two epimers of ergine in profile, as we saw before, side by side. At the right, we now clearly see the reversed positions of the amide side group and the hydrogen on the position 8 carbon. Both ergine and isoergine have their D ring in the chair conformation, as we just saw previously. Now, this brings us to a further complication that is specific to ergine, but not to LSD. And the question we must now ask is whether isoergine also exhibits flipping of its D-ring back and forth between the chair and the boat forms that we see with ergine. In fact, isoergine does not change its conformation, for it is prevented from doing so by the formation of a hydrogen bond, which locks it into the chair form. Here's how that happens. I'm now going to add to the nitrogen atoms at position 6 of these molecules. What are called, next one, lone electron pairs. There they are there, those two little red things on each one. Now, nitrogen has rather more electrons than it uses for its normal 3 bonds. And these extra electrons cause one side of the atom to have a decidedly negative charge. Remember that electrons have negative charge. In this case, when a hydrogen attached to another nitrogen, those hydrogens attached to another nitrogen, are close enough to this negative charge, a hydrogen bond is formed. There's the hydrogen bond. In the case of ergine, we can see from the top model that the corresponding hydrogen is too far away from the lone electron pair, and it is also shielded from it by the position 7 carbon. A hydrogen bond in ergine can, however, form when it is in the boat conformation, as we see here. But since, in general, the boat form of lysergic acid compounds is less energetically favorable, the hydrogen bond in ergine does not prevent it from changing its conformation. All these results were confirmed in a fascinating paper in the journal Tetrahedron by Bernardi and Barbieri, and all they used was the infrared spectra of these molecules. Quite astonishing. So we have the possibility, next slide, please. There we go. We have the possibility that a molecule of ergine can be in one of 3 different states. It can be ergine in the chair or boat conformation, or it can be isoergine in the chair conformation. And in many chemical and physical situations, the 3 forms are constantly converting themselves from one to the others and achieving a typical equilibrium distribution. We therefore must consider that in an ergot preparation made according to our suggested method, and in morning glory seed extracts as prepared by Mesoamerican shamans, we are not dealing with pure ergine or pure isoergine. Both pure compounds have been tested and found wanting by some investigators, including Dr. Hoffman. I would like to suggest, therefore, that it is the equilibrium mixture of ergine and isoergine that may actually be the true psychoactive of the Kukian and Ololuqui as well. Since ergine spontaneously changes to isoergine when in solution over a period of an hour or more, any process to partially hydrolyze the alkaloids of ergot, such as our proposed recipe, or even the Aztec shaman's procedure for extracting Ololuqui, should result in an equilibrium mixture of these 3 states represented here. Taking either ergine or isoergine as pure compounds, however, may not result in the equilibrium mixture arriving at brain receptors. The equilibrium reaction takes some time to occur, perhaps an hour or more, and is brought about most effectively by basic conditions, and neither in the stomach nor in the blood do we find sufficiently basic conditions for the equilibrium to be readily established within a short time period. Concerning the psychoactivity of ergine-isoergine mixtures, I have long had great confidence that extracts of morning glory seed, and by analogy, a partial hydrolysis preparation made from ergot, could be quite powerfully psychoactive. In the late 1960s, when I started my research on these matters, I had gone to Mexico to experiment with morning glory seeds. And to begin, I extracted several kilos of seeds using a simple process, purifying an alcohol, an alcoholic extract between organic solvents in the alternating presence of aqueous solutions of ammonia and tartaric acid. After a couple of days' work, I obtained a nearly colorless syrup that exhibited the bright blue fluorescence typical of active lysergic acid compounds. A few milligrams of this syrup taken in a capsule produced one of the most powerful psychedelic experiences I had known. And by then I had already taken high-dose LSD several times, as well as a few other notorious psychedelic agents. Ever since, it has therefore been a mystery to me why ergine should be such a fickle psychedelic, failing with some trials and yet succeeding in others. My explanation, perhaps not entirely satisfactory, I admit, is that my extraction procedure allowed the equilibration of the original extracted ergine to the three ergine variants, and it was this mixture that was so effective. We do know, of course, that sometimes a mixture of two or more drugs can be more effective than any single component of the mixture alone. The question kept popping up in my mind, however, why shouldn't ergine itself be reliably psychoactive? It is a close relative of LSD and its cousin, the dimethylamide, both of which are undeniably and strongly psychedelic. But perhaps this flipping of the D-ring between chair and boat conformations made ergine less available to their target brain receptors, or even prevented ergine from remaining at receptors known to be affected by LSD. There are other examples of drugs whose receptor affinity is limited by such conformation change. So it seemed a good bet that this might be the case with ergine as well. LSD, having ethyl groups and not hydrogens on the amide nitrogen, cannot form the hydrogen bond, which stabilizes the boat form of the D-ring as an ergine, or which stabilizes isoergine to a unique conformation. So LSD remains exclusively in the chair form, and this might help to explain its extraordinary potency. And perhaps isoergine, like LSD, by virtue of its not changing conformation, actually was psychoactive, in spite of it being an isoderivative expected to be inactive. An additional consideration about the psychoactivity of LSD compared to ergine is also significant. It is, in fact, the stabilization of isoergine in the boat conformation by the hydrogen bond that affects the equilibrium concentrations of the two epimers, ergine versus isoergine. This will depend on the particular solvent, of course, but in water or in the body, we should expect that an approximately 50-50 mixture of ergine and isoergine will exist. But since there is no hydrogen bonding possible with LSD to stabilize the iso form, the equilibrium concentration of LSD versus iso-LSD is far from 50-50. In fact, the equilibrium attained by LSD in water solution or the body is 88% in the active epimer and only 12% iso-LSD. In addition, it takes a very long time, up to a week, for pure active LSD to epimerize to that equilibrium concentration, so that a dose of pure active LSD would arrive at the brain intact with essentially no conversion to its epimer, iso-LSD. I'd like to mention one further experiment I performed, rather recently in fact. I decided to perform a test with the wood ash recipe I had proposed in the Eleusis paper. Although ergot was not available to me, by coincidence, I suffer from migraines. And for relief, I use the common preparation called Geinergen, or Geinergen in French. This pharmaceutical product consists of 1 milligram of ergotamine tartrate mixed with caffeine. Ergotamine is, you will remember, the principal toxic ergopeptine alkaloid in ergot. I decided to see if the process we suggest in our paper might convert the ergotamine in a migraine tablet to something that gave a psychoactive effect. Now, for migraine relief, one can take up to 5 of these ergotamine tablets in a day, and having occasionally needed the full dose, I can testify that even 5 milligrams has no psychoactive effect whatsoever. This provided a sort of control on my experiments. I performed 3 trials, using first 1 ergotamine tablet, and then 2, and then 3. Now, since ergotamine tartrate, the actual compound in these tablets, is a much larger and therefore heavier molecule than ergine, a simple calculation shows that converting 1 milligram of ergotamine will ideally yield only a maximum of 0.4 milligram, or 400 micrograms, of ergine and isoergine in their equilibrium mixture. In the first trial, I heated one tablet containing 1 milligram of ergotamine with 200 milligrams of hardwood ash in 20 milliliters of vodka in a kitchen double boiler. I'll get to something on that in a minute. And I found that after 1 hour, the alcohol had boiled off. I continued to heat this mixture for an additional 2 hours at around 50 degrees centigrade, and then neutralized the mixture with vitamin C, or ascorbic acid. Decanting the liquid from the residue of solids left by the wood ash, I then drank the result. A definite but weak psychoactive effect was noticed. Repeating the experiment with 2 and then 3 migraine tablets, the result was stronger and left no doubt in my mind that the partial hydrolysis process we hypothesized does indeed happen to ergotamine. Whether the reaction goes to completion to convert all the ergotamine to ergine and isoergine will require more precise testing in a proper analytical laboratory, as will the determination of the ideal conditions for this reaction. It is possible that under the conditions I used, less than complete conversion took place, or that side reactions took place that might have produced other, possibly toxic compounds. I did notice some gastric disturbances serious enough to warrant caution by anyone who would wish to repeat the experiment before more complete laboratory testing can evaluate the procedure. But there is little reason to believe that if the partial hydrolysis process occurs with the ergotamine in a Geinergan tablet, then that it would not occur with the ergotamine or other ergopeptines in ergot. In my experiments here, I used vodka as a solvent, since in a Geinergan tablet, the ergotamine content exists as tiny crystals, and an alcohol-water mixture would enhance the low solubility of these ergotamine crystals. In part 2 of our paper, in Eleusis, however, Dan Perrine argues that when treating powdered ergot, the fatty acid content of ergot would sufficiently solubilize the ergotamine content so that the ancient Greeks need not have used distilled alcohol, which, of course, they didn't have available to them. In addition, the ergotamine in ergot sclerotia probably exists in an amorphous and not a crystalline state, and it is largely the stability of the crystalline state that requires dissolving in alcohol for hydrolysis. My experiments also used ascorbic acid to neutralize the wood ash, but the Greeks might have employed something else, vinegar even. Neutralizing would make the brew more palatable, and in addition, it would augment the solubility of ergine, isoergine in body fluids, since these alkaloids easily form salts with acids, such as ascorbic, tartaric, or even hydrochloric acid is found in the stomach. The salts are far more soluble than the free base alkaloids. I would again caution anyone who would wish to try this recipe that I cannot say whether the process completely converts the ergotamine to ergine, isoergine, nor can I specify exactly how long or what temperature the idealized process would require. Only laboratory testing would determine this. In addition, to fully confirm my hypothesis, assayed ergot should be used, and chromatographic analysis used to determine the ideal conditions necessary for a complete partial hydrolysis to ergine and for the equilibrium with isoergine to be established. In my final test, I used 3 ergotamine tablets. The results of this trial merit some further thoughts on the Kukian hypothesis. With 3 tablets, the effect was, of course, even stronger, although at this level, it was still not nearly the equivalent of my trial of morning glory extracts in Mexico. I believe that the dose I used on that trial was much higher, perhaps as much as 10 milligrams. And of course, the Ololiquiax extract contained a minor amount of other possible psychoactive agents. With 3 converted ergotamine tablets, ideally producing 1,200 micrograms of ergine-isoergine mixture, the effect came on quickly after 15 or 20 minutes. The effect, however, was not at all the same as LSD or peyote. It was more hypnotic and inward than the typical psychedelic experience. The ergine-isoergine experience also seems less dramatic, more gentle, and leads one to recline with the eyes closed, whereupon mental processes seem kaleidoscopic and influenced strongly by set and setting. Opening one's eyes to a bright daylight scene tended to minimize the effects, so it may perhaps be more suitable for use in dark surroundings, which would accentuate the effects. My set, of course, was merely one of testing a chemical theory, and a set and setting, as might have been provided at Eleusis, a much more activating one. Reflecting on the experience, however, it occurred to me that it may well be just the type of drug that would have been most suitable to use in a large gathering of persons, such as at Eleusis, where most or all participants would have been previously inexperienced with psychedelic drugs. In addition, the ergine-isoergine effect I experienced, it would seem that the setting provided by the Eleusis priest would have predominated over personal set. The ergine-isoergine experience would seem to allow a maximum of set and setting to be provided by the priests and guides, both during the experience and during the long preparatory period before taking the drug. Personal idiosyncrasies that often come to the fore with LSD or the other strong psychedelic agents might be less observed in the ergine-isoergine experience. Full-blown psychedelic experiences such as produced by LSD or psilocybin are perhaps not as suitable for large groups of persons who have little or no previous experience with psychedelic drugs. Experience shows that even with a small group of novices, at least one or two individuals are always quite likely to freak out and need special attention, disrupting the setting for everyone else. This was, of course, well demonstrated during the famous Good Friday Marsh Chapel experiment of 1962, in which 10 Christian theological students were given psilocybin in a religious setting. One of them reacted so strongly that he had to be sedated so the rest of the experiment could proceed, and the other participants not distracted from their own experiences. To conclude, I have just one other thought about ergot in Greek and European times that might support our theories. Ergot most reliably produces high levels of alkaloids with a cool and humid springtime followed by a hot and dry summer. Without ideal conditions, ergot can, and often does, produce very little alkaloid at all. This would help to explain the unpredictability of ergotism outbreaks in Europe, despite the fact that ergot would have been more or less common in every single harvest, since in order to reproduce, it must do so annually. This would also explain why it took so long to realize that ergot was the cause of ergotism. Many physicians long insisted that ergot was harmless, and if they had tested ergot during the years when it was of inferior quality, no harm would have resulted from ingesting it in modest amounts. Now, Greece surely has hot, dry summers, but what of the cool, humid springtime that ergot requires for high alkaloid production? According to some recent climate studies, the Mediterranean basin countries were far more humid in classical times due to a far greater forest cover. In the latitude of Greece, and considering the effects of the Indian Ocean seasonal weather patterns, one may presume that most of this extra humidity would have occurred during winter and spring, and that summers were, as now, hot and dry. We may suspect, then, that ancient Greece was a practically ideal climate for the natural and yearly reproduction of high-quality ergot, the essential ingredient the Kaikion used for nearly two millennia. During that 2,000-year period, Greece rose from a quite primitive, early Bronze Age society to heights of civilization in which, in some ways, we still have not reattained. Might the widespread use of lysergic acid psychedelics have helped in a large way to bring about such a miracle? One further clue that has recently come to light about Eleusis bears mentioning. Some of you may have read the short poem. I think you can read it there. The short poem by the medieval mystic poet Rumi at the homepage of the Psychedelic Library. These lines are from the Masnavi, a very well-known Sufi work. Alas, the forbidden fruits were eaten, and thereby the warm life of reason congealed. A grain of wheat eclipsed the sun of Adam, like as the dragon's tail dulls the brightness of the moon. It was many years ago that I discovered this short passage, and in the translation I was reading, there was a footnote to it explaining that Muslims believe the forbidden fruit to have been wheat. I had, in fact, just read the Masnavi after I had read the Road to Eleusis, and I had immediately concluded that either the direct knowledge of the Kukian, or at least rumors about it, had persisted for over 1,000 years and become part of the beliefs of the medieval Sufi mystics. For many years, however, I was not able to find further references that would confirm the hint that this translation of the Masnavi suggested. In a paper soon to appear in the Journal of Psychoactive Drugs, Frederick Danaway, Alan Piper, and I present new evidence that the medieval Sufi poet's reference to wheat as the forbidden fruit is quite widespread in the literature of the time and may well betray a still lingering knowledge of one of the oldest and longest enduring religious rites ever practiced, the yearly autumnal celebrations at Eleusis in ancient Greece. Thank you very much. Carl Ruck, ladies and gentlemen.
I believe we move to a circle for those of you who want to have further discussion.
That's not too bad. Yes, there's a forum outside, I think, over on that side, where we attempt to answer some questions.
Eure Stimmung sei heute süß wie der Honig, ruhig wie das Wasser und schön wie die Blumen.